Oh, hi, I'm Mark, an art teacher, a professional artist, and this week's video is going to be for you if you've ever wanted to become a digital artist, because this is my beginner's guide to digital art! Yes, if you've ever wondered which tablet to get, what software to download, what brushes to install, this video should have an answer to most of your questions, so let's get started. Woo! So first of all, new setup. What? After 7 years of doing YouTube videos, finally decided to upgrade for my webcam. So hopefully moving forward, the video quality should be a little bit better, at least more legit. Like you can see my pores now in this thing. Yeah. Oh, and also real quick, check this out. Now I'm in Photoshop. Now I'm back. What? So next level. But enough of this. Back to the subject of this video. So as you know, if you're a subscriber, I release videos like this every single week, and I read all the comments all the time, and a lot of it has to do with beginner stuff, beginner things. And you know, some of you might have been watching my videos for a little while now. Maybe you knew nothing about art before, and now you're like, maybe I want to try to get into that digital art thing. Or maybe you've already started but you're having a couple issues. Don't worry, it's gonna be okay. Most of your questions will be answered after this video, and we're gonna split it up in three different parts. So first we're gonna start with the hardware, what we're actually gonna be drawing on, so different tablets. Then we'll take a look at painting software, so different alternatives, free ones, more expensive ones, and then how to set everything up so that you can get started on your art journey. So first things first, let's take a look at a bunch of tablets. So which one should you buy? When it comes to digital art, of course, we're not gonna be using a mouse. So that's old school. That's what I used to do when I started. I don't recommend it. You have no dexterity with a mouse. Instead, you should buy something like this. So if this is your first venture into digital art, I wouldn't recommend that you spend too much money. So first things first, it would probably be good to buy a cheap pen tablet, something like this. So this is a Wacom Draw, $70, $80, something like that. And it's a pen tablet. And so you have a pen, you have a little pad here, no screens, nothing. And then you plug that into your computer. And then this basically acts as your mouse. Now, one thing that's good to understand with these tablets here is that you'll be drawing and you'll be looking at your screen, right? So there's no screen on there. So there's a little bit of a disconnect there. And it took me at least about a month to get used to that disconnect. So if this is what you choose, you know, just make sure that you go in it with reasonable expectations that you probably are going to suck at the beginning. Let's just put it this way. But just give it a little bit of time and this will eventually become second nature. And so one thing that's good to know is that just because it's cheap doesn't mean that it's not good. This tablet here is way better than what I bought for $500 when I was younger. This beats it. So definitely not bad. And also there are some other brands like XP Pen or Huion that might be actually cheaper than this and might deliver just as good of a quality. So good to check those out. Now, if you have a bigger budget and you don't want to worry about, you know, that disconnect between your hand and your eyes, well, you could look into something like this. So this would be a pen display tablet. Still just a tablet, not a computer. None of these are computers. So you always need a laptop or a desktop to make these work. But this one here, the Wacom One, I think it's around $400, something like that. And it is basically a screen. So that could act as your second monitor. And it's the same thing here. You draw on it, but you'll see your canvas. So let's say you load up Photoshop or any painting software, you'll be able to paint directly on the screen. Pretty damn nice. And that's what I use, just a bigger one. I have another one here by XP Pen. About the same price, but bigger. So this one is 16 inches instead. So yeah, definitely shop around. There are a bunch of alternatives that you can choose from. So I recommend Wacom. This is what I've used for the longest time. They last, they're really, really good. Wacom, XP Pen is another good one, and Huion. So those three brands I feel are safe bets. There might be other ones, maybe not as well known, that might break. Maybe the customer support is not that great. But when it comes to the hardware, that's pretty much it. So you get pen tablets, pen display tablets, more expensive, easier to use, more comfortable, a little bit less easy to use. It takes a little while getting used to this, but it does the trick just as well. But as I said, you'll need a computer to run these. So if you prefer something that's a little bit more portable, there's always the iPad Pro, very similar to a pen display tablet. You draw directly on the screen and you can take it on the go because it's a computer and a tablet all in one, just a little bit more expensive than any of these. So down in the description below, I'll put links to all of these along with the reviews that I did for all of those tablets in case you want to check them out. Mood change. All right, let's move on to the next part of this video, the software. So when it comes to the painting software, there's a lot of options out there, including free alternatives. And so we'll take a look at those first. There's three in particular that I recommend. First one would be Krita, second one, Medibang Paint Pro, and the third one would be Autodesk Sketchbook. So I actually did a review of all of those not too long ago, so I'll put a link down in the description if you want to have a deeper look. But basically, any of these are free to download. You can get started right away. There's no like paywall or anything like that. So highly recommend for most beginners. Now, one step up from that, in that category, I would put Clip Studio Paint and Procreate for iPad, iPad only. So those two, Clip Studio Paint, very, very popular. I would say most of my students use that. It's just a very complete painting software and it's relatively cheap. You buy it once and it's yours forever. Same deal with Procreate. I know a lot of professional artists that use those tools in their day-to-day job. And then if we go to the next level, you would have something like Photoshop. So Photoshop is 10 bucks a month. And so it's something, it's a service, right? So it's not a software that you buy, that you acquire and it's yours. You have to keep paying for it to keep using it. Now, given the fact that it used to be multiple hundreds of dollars, it's an easier sell for most people. That's what I use because it's worth it for me. But a lot of that stuff might not be so relevant if you're just starting as a digital artist. So of course, Photoshop is a professional software. It's going to have a lot of features that you probably don't need at all. And so probably not the first software that I would recommend if this is, you know, your first step into digital art. Grab one of the free alternatives. You'll be pretty happy for a long time. Now let's move on to the next part of this video. How do you use all this stuff? But first, another mood change. Ooh. All right, so in this final part of the video of this beginner's guide to digital art, we're going to take a look at three different things. No, four different things. First, we'll see what happens when you plug in a tablet, how to get that working with your computer. Easy. Then we'll see how to start a new project, how to get used to the tablet, to the pencil, and how to practice to get better faster. Then we'll take a look at some of the more common tools that you'll find in those painting softwares, the ones that you should really know. And finally, real quick, we'll take a look at custom brushes. So wait, was that five or four? Whatever. What do we have here? All right, so you've just gotten your first tablet, whether it's a pen display tablet or a pen tablet, it doesn't matter. You plug it into your computer and then it doesn't really work. Yikes. So of course, the first thing that you'll want to do after that is to go and grab the drivers of the website from the company that you bought the tablet from. Here, as a random example, I'm on the Wacom website. I would just select the tablet that I have and go ahead and download and install the drivers for it. As soon as those drivers are installed, you should be able to use the tablet pretty much right off the bat. So here for Wacom, you'll be able to go into your tablet properties and then edit a bunch of stuff in here. But to be honest, I've never touched any of this stuff. All the defaults are defaults for a reason because they work pretty well in most cases. But one thing that you'll want to do though is calibrate your monitor. It'll make you go through something like this, where you just tap with your pen, those little arrows, and now your screen should be calibrated. Easy peasy. Now, while we're on this window here, you'll see down there the little option for use Windows Ink. So this is Windows only, of course. And this is something that I highly recommend that you uncheck if you run into any kind of issue with your tablet. So oftentimes Windows Ink will kind of interfere with the proper function of your tablet. If not, no problem, leave it the way it is. For example, if you're not getting pen pressure, or maybe something is just not working at all, try disabling that and then try it again. In my case, I'm running Windows. I have it disabled using a Wacom tablet. So you might have to do that too. But aside from that, ready to go. We can close all of that. And now if you open a painting software of your choice, you should be able to draw. And out of the box, you should have pen pressure. So the harder that you press on your pen, the bolder the stroke. Of course, this is going to depend on your brushes, but you should be able to test this pretty easily because pen pressure will typically affect the width of the brush. So the harder you press, the bolder the line. And this is just the first thing that you need to make sure it works. This way you'll be able to draw some nice brush strokes that have a lot of character. It can start very, very small and end up being a lot bigger in the center. And in Photoshop, so this is going to vary depending on the painting software, but in Photoshop, if this is not working, you gotta make sure that these two here, this one there, and that little option there, both are checked. This one ties the pen pressure to the opacity of the color, and this one ties it to the width of your brush. Without it, when you draw, it'll be something like this. So very limited in comparison, as you can see. No, thank you. Now, real quick, before I show you a couple of exercises to get more familiarized with your tablet, get the hang of your new tool, we'll create a new canvas. Like most software, Control N does the trick, or you can go in here, File, New. Now in Photoshop, just like in most painting softwares, you're gonna get a couple of things in here. The most important is going to be your size. So the width and the height in pixels. So make sure that you select pixels, not anything else. And what I recommend as a good size to get started, so something that's not gonna be too small, that you'll see all the pixels, everything will be pixelated, but something that's not too big either, that will make your computer catch on fire. Usually 1080p resolution is a good starting point. For everything else here, you can also change this if you ever plan to print your drawings. Make sure that you got enough resolution. This is only for printing. And then look at the other options that I have here and make sure that yours is something that's similar. All right, so let's try it here. Nice and clean brush strokes. But if we zoom in, we can see that we don't have that much resolution. We just zoom in a little bit and we can start to see pixels. So actually what I usually recommend is to go double that. So go 4K, which would give us a resolution of like 3840 by 2160 or anything close to that. Now, once again, this is a good balance between performance and quality. If you're printing, for example, something that's gonna be huge, probably want a little bit more resolution than that. But for most of you, this should do the trick. Now, before we look at the actual tools, let's take a look at their shortcuts, their hotkeys, because those are tools that you'll be using a lot of the times. And so I have kind of like my cheat sheet here for Adobe Photoshop hotkeys. So feel free to save that for later. Pretty useful. But for the most part, what you'll be using the majority of the time will be those two here. And Alt click for color picker. If you want to select a color here, let's say I want to select the blue. I click Alt and then I tap here and now I have the blue selected. I want to select this blue here, do the same thing, Alt click. So alternating between my brush, my eraser, and making sure that you can color pick. This should allow you to do a lot of stuff already while keeping things super simple. And of course, this way you won't have to go click here to select the brush or to select the eraser every single time. Ain't nobody got time for that. All right, so I know that there's a lot of icons in here. It can be a little bit overwhelming if you're brand new to this. And also your layout, your UI might be slightly different. If you want to have a similar layout as I do, those are the ones that I have activated, the navigator, this one here, layers, my layer tab, my history, to go back in time and kind of undo, and well, my color picker here, my color box. Now with that, here is one exercise that I highly, highly recommend that you do often. You don't even need to do it digitally, actually. This is something that you should just do all the time for pen control, for dexterity. And while you do it, make sure that you don't have any smoothing here. So smoothing is a hex. Brushstroke will actually go a little slower and kind of even out the input to create a more continuous clean line. The only reason why you would ever want to have some smoothing in here is if you have like shaky hands, as in like a medical condition, or if your tablet is just really, really bad. And when you draw a straight line like this, it kind of jitters a little bit. In that case, understandable, feel free to use a little bit of smoothing. But if you're trying to improve your dexterity, which is the whole point of this exercise, make sure that you disable it so that what you draw is what you get, just like on a real paper. And there's really two exercises that I would recommend, at least to get you started. First, drawing circles with one line, one continuous line. The circle is one of those things that you'll draw all the time. And so practice drawing at different sizes, getting as clean a result as possible, as consistently as possible. And then the other one would be tracing a line, a curved line preferably, nice and quick and confident, even if you're not. And then trying to draw as equally fast and with as much confidence, another brush stroke parallel to the first one, but faster than this. And if you can, closer than this without ever touching. So this kind of exercise is really good for dexterity in general. This is something that I actually recommend that you do on paper as well, like I said. It's not just digital, but if you're new to using a pen tablet, this should help break it in for you a little bit faster. All right, now we're almost done. There are just a few of the tools in here that are very important that you should totally know. Otherwise, you're gonna have a hard time doing digital art. And the first one here will be layers. I'm pretty sure most of you know what layers are, but just in case, it's basically another sheet of paper that you're gonna add on top of your background layer. And so now I'm on a separate layer and we can't really see anything in here, but that's the point because there's nothing on this layer. It's like an empty transparent page. But as soon as I start to draw on it, now you'll see very, very subtle, probably you won't be able to see, but it appeared here. So there's a little bit of a preview. And now this is on a separate layer. So let's say I hide my background. The background is hidden, but this remains. And so if I want to erase some of these lines, I can go ahead without any problem. I won't erase the background because it's on a separate layer. Now in Photoshop, and this is going to be very similar across all the different painting software, either way. But you'll have first the option to toggle visibility for that layer. So on and off, usually be kind of like a little eye here. Up here, you're going to have the opacity for that layer that's selected. So you can reduce it or increase it. Now let's say I draw something on a new layer. I can also change the blending style for that layer. So by default, everything is set to normal. It's opaque paint. But let's say I go and select multiply. then it'll add the paint on top of everything that's underneath that stack. And as a result, everything will get darker and darker. And so we can play around here with the different options. Usually, once again, those will be pretty much the same across the different software. So let's set that back to normal. And then finally, the last thing here that's pretty useful will be the alpha lock. So in Photoshop, it'll be this little thing here, the little square. Or in Procreate, for example, it'll be called something different. It'll be called alpha lock. But essentially what it does is it locks in everything that you've painted so far. So you can't add any more paint while still being able to modify what you have here. So if I paint right now, I'm just painting over it as usual. But if I undo that and I select the alpha lock right here and I try to paint again, as you can see, I'm only able to paint within what's been locked before, the paint that's already on that layer. So this is a very useful tool in a lot of different scenarios. But yeah, when it comes to layers, that should be pretty much everything that you need to know. You should be able to do a lot of stuff with just that. Now, moving on from that, let's go and check out one more tool here that's pretty useful. It's going to be the lasso tool or the selection box. So this is going to create a box. This will be freehand, both the same. So if I create a new layer here and create a selection, when I paint, I'm going to be painting within that selection. So very similar to the alpha lock, except that in this particular case, I can deselect and then do it again on the same layer without having to touch the alpha lock. To deselect from a selection, because often you'll try to paint elsewhere and it's not gonna work, it will only allow you to paint within the selection. So to unselect, you click Control D, or whatever the equivalent of that is on a Mac, who knows? And now you're able to paint wherever you want because there's no more selection. Now, why would I use a selection? Well, maybe for something like this. So let's say I wanna create a nice gradient. You can go like this and maybe add a little bit of highlight here, and wow, suddenly I have a sphere. And I can be pretty messy with my brush strokes because I am bound to this selection only. I wanna get out of there, Control D. Oh, also important, something that I haven't mentioned, but to navigate in here, to drag the canvas around, you just press and hold spacebar and then click. This allows us to pan around the canvas. And in Photoshop, at least, you can also zoom in and out by clicking Control Space instead and dragging this way. So just the spacebar, it drags it, Control spacebar, zooms in and out. All right, now I want to save this masterpiece. How do I do that? I'm going to go ahead and Control S. We can go here and File, Save. And here is going to bring up a window and you're able to save it in whatever format that you prefer. Usually, if you're planning to show your masterpiece on the interwebs, you'll go for a JPEG, call it whatever, and hit save. Now we're going to get some compression option here. Basically, you want to set it to baseline, nothing to change here. And usually select a quality in between 8 or 10. Any more than that, you won't notice the difference and the file will be much larger. And any less than 8, you'll start to get a lot of artifacts because of the compression. File will be smaller, but it also look like crap. 9, 10, usually it's pretty good. Now, of course, if you want to save your Photoshop file or your work file, regardless of the painting software that you use, if you want to be able to access all your layers and come back in here and keep painting, you'll want to save it as a PSD, not a JPEG. So by default, it will always save as a PSD. And this is a Photoshop file, Photoshop document. So in most cases, you're going to have two documents, your working file, your PSD, and your JPEG once you're done. And we can open up the JPEG again here because remember, we're working in 4K resolution. So this might be a little big to post on the internet. What we can do here is go image size and reduce that by a little bit. Let's say by 50%, but this is still pretty good. Big enough so that we can retain all the details, but it's not going to take forever to load online. And we're done. No, wait, not true. One last thing, custom brushes. So when you open up any painting software, you're going to get a set of default brushes. Default brushes, they work pretty well. What I recommend is that you find a soft brush. So something like this, you'll be able to find those in any painting software and use that for all your shading needs, right? So maybe you're trying to draw a sphere with some highlights here, and you want everything to be nice and soft and smooth, then you'll want to use a soft brush. If you don't, and instead you use a hard brush, well, when it comes to time to paint in the highlights, you'll get a lot of brush strokes that you'll have to fight to get rid of all of this. So just a lot more work. Now it can give a cool look to it, and I highly recommend that you experiment with all this stuff. But unless you have good amount of control over your pen, good amount of dexterity, this is going to be a little bit more challenging to do. So for that reason, I highly recommend for best results that you use a soft brush. Otherwise, you'll be left to do what I'm doing right now and like control picking, kind of like the in-between color, painting a little bit more of that very, very softly, then selecting another kind of in-between color and going about it this way, refining with time and patience. And then maybe by the time you get old, you'll be done. Now, those are the brushes that I recommended to use right off the bat. But let's say you've been playing around with this a little bit more And then you keep hearing me say that I'm offering my custom brushes for free. And you're like, maybe I want to try those. Well, first of all, you can find a link to them in the top right corner of the screen right here. And I'll put a link down in the description below as well. Let's say you download them and you want to try them out. Brushes that I've made personally for my own needs. First of all, of course, you'll need to download them. And then from here, once downloaded in Photoshop, you go ahead and select your brush. So B, press B or go here and click it. And then you can right click. And this is going to load up all your brushes, all your default brushes if you haven't added any custom ones yet. And then from there, you just got to click on the little gear icon here and import brushes. You'll just want to find the brush back in question and you can just go ahead and load it up. And now you'll be able to use all the brushes that I typically use, including MB Chalk, the one that I use for most of my line art needs. Even if you're using a different software like Clip Studio Paint or Procreate, you're also able to download those brushes and import them into your software. I can't guarantee that they'll work 100% like they do in Photoshop. Haven't tested it myself, but I know that you can import them and it works apparently. But yeah, there we have it. So this is going to wrap up this beginner's guide to digital art. Hopefully this will help you get started if digital art is something that you've discovered a passion for, completely understandable. Or if you had any other kind of more basic questions and things like that, hopefully that answered those. If it did help, make sure that you subscribe to the channel for more videos like this every single week, and make sure that you destroy the like button. It's the law. So did it help? Let me know down in the comments below. Like I said at the beginning, I read all the comments all the time. And if you have any suggestions for future video, something that you'd really, really want me to cover, feel free to leave it down below as well. Most of my videos are usually based on recommendations from you guys. All right, and make sure that you tune in next week for something pretty special. If you'll excuse me, I have some Cyberpunk 2077 to go play. So I'll see you next time.